BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art issues with three guests and the host, James Carroll. Home viewers are invited to call and offer comments or questions during the live telecast. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hi, how are we doing tonight? My name is Ron Schira. I'm with, Welcome to another edition of NAP Connections. I'm your host tonight, Ron Schira. Said that again. And with me, I have a guest, guest painter, artist, also an art organizer. This is Lynn Millar. Pleasure to have you here today.
Nice to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Well, it's great. Well, it's, we're going to talk about Lynn's art, and we had a little technical difficulties there, so we're starting later. But we want to talk at first about her background, her history, okay. Her stuff, and then we'll show a couple of things about her work and also about some exhibits that are taking place in the area. Okay, well, a pleasure, Lynn.
Thank you.
So I'm calming down now.
Okay, so good. We're unwinding a little bit.
We're unwinding, yeah. That's when things happen. This is live. We'd also like to invite you to call in if you like. This is a live show right now on the 25th, and it's 610-378-0426. So give us a call if you have any questions or comments. So Lynn, tell us about yourself.
I've been painting, drawing, playing with art since I could talk, since I could walk, since I could hold a brush or a pencil. That was always real important to me.
Mm-hmm.
All through school. I went to Kutztown University. It was Kutztown State Teachers College when I started there.
Okay.
As an art education major.
Mm-hmm.
And just loved art. I mean, everything, my art, my life's always been around art and animals, because I'm a dog person also.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been on this station with my dog a few times.
Oh, okay, that's cool.
I've been, in college, I sort of discovered watercolor. I really hadn't done any watercolor before that. And so I've become mostly known, or at least recognize myself or declare myself sort of a watercolor artist. Mm-hmm. I'm a signature member of Pennsylvania Watercolor Society, Philadelphia Watercolor Society, and Baltimore Watercolor Society. And that's sort of a little bit of an exclusive club in the sense that you have to get into their shows numerous times before they'll even consider making you a signature member. So.
Right.
And that just means you can put their initials next to your signature if you choose to.
Mm-hmm.
And
so if anybody sees a PWS or...
Yes, you know, that would mean your Pennsylvania Watercolor Society.
Mm-hmm.
PWCS, Philadelphia Watercolor Society. And they're both very enjoyable groups. They put on events and things that you can participate in as a watercolor artist. It's mm-hmm. It's a real learning experience.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, it's a good organization too, because there's a lot of I think you have to be a talented watercolorist in order to get into it. So they just don't take anybody.
Definitely skill involved. It's interesting to see sort of how you can get in. I mean, you spend years trying to figure it out. To some extent, it's technique. I mean, they're not going to put someone in who's not very good at applying watercolor, for one thing. So there has to be some technique, but also ideas, concept, subject matter, all those things also contribute to whether
mm-hmm.
a juror will select the work to go in. So,
right.
So they each have their own vision of what the show should look like and what should be in it.
Right.
So it's a way of getting involved in art, but it's certainly not the only way.
Oh no, there's many, many different ways. But if for that particular avenue, it's a good choice, especially.
Yeah, I also, besides the transparent watercolor, I do like some of the opaque mediums like acrylic, casein, and even pastel, because sometimes I need a break from watercolor. Watercolor, you almost have to paint in a negative way. You're constantly thinking about where things aren't. So it's darker there, the darker colors and things. You're almost working negatively.
Well, and a watercolor purist will always never use white paint.
Correct.
Never use a white opaque.
Correct.
You know, so the white is actually an empty space on the paper.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's the paper coming through with nothing on it. So, and white space is very important in setting the whole tone of it. So, you know, it's almost like you have to put your brain around, twist your brain around to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I like to go occasionally to the acrylics and the casein and the different mediums that are not transparent, so I can sort of put my brain back, straighten it back out again a little bit.
Yeah. Need normally. A vacation from it.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Uh-huh. Maybe we can look at some of the pieces.
Sure. Let's go to your website here. We have her website up, so we'll probably have a couple of things going here. Well, anyway.
Now this is an acrylic.
Uh huh.
Currently in the show Larger Than Life, which is in Studio B in Boyertown right now.
Uh huh.
And this one I believe is called Rosebud. And it's actually a group of several. I took several different pictures of different roses and things and worked them together, and then they figured out the background, and sort of as a positive negative, you'll kind of see that they're both things going on. And that was more of a design element that I just sort of worked in as I put it together, sort of.
Well, you're working with color and space here, so it's a.
Yeah.
I think that's a lot of it, and it almost looks like, being an acrylic. It has a screen print sort of a feel to it.
Yeah, I did it very much, very flat colors. I mean, you can work with acrylics that aren't flat colors, but I often find myself working with these flat colors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, and it's nice, too, that there's no edges around it, that the edges are the color, which is very nice. So let's move ahead to another one, I think. We have to go away from that one, and
this one's also in Larger Than Life. This one's called Wild Flight, and it's a budgie, a parakeet, and based on and those flowers are something that you see a lot of in Australia. I travel to Australia fairly often because I have relatives there, and this is a native bird of Australia, and those flowers are everywhere in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
So I put it together as one painting. I always love the birds.
So how big is this painting?
That painting is, I believe, 20 by 24.
So the bird, a budgie, is pretty small.
Yeah, but it's about double the size of the actual bird.
Yeah, yeah. So, and the colors kind of match it too. That yellow against the green really works.
Yeah, sort of snaps. And actually, originally, that yellow strip was like a coral color. And just like, ugh, it didn't work. I don't know if you can even see a trace of it. I think I obliterated it all. I painted the whole thing over yellow, my original painting.
Well, it works.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And I also like the red markings in the back of it.
That I do with alcohol. You'll see that in a lot of my acrylics.
Mm-hmm.
I have like there's a red background. Then I cover it with the blue, and then I spray it with acrylic, and the acrylic sort of pushes away the blue and lets the red show through. You'll see that in a couple of them.
Mm-hmm.
In that Turkey Flats truck painting, it's in there too.
Mm, okay. So let's...
We could go back and look at the rest of this page if you want to.
Okay, well, we're here right
what
now.
We
let's
have?
See. Okay, here's...
These are all from that show. That's that one's called Insecticide. And that's actually based on a beetle that I photographed over at the Reading Museum when they had the beetle show this summer.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I thought this beetle was so bizarre, so interesting with his shell and things and his long antenna and legs. So
yeah, that was an interesting show.
That was fun.
Mm-hmm. I liked it.
That this was one of the Beatles in one of the glass cases, and he was he must be about 4 inches high, in real life. Mm-hmm. In my painting, he's probably about 6 inches high, but in real life, he was probably almost 4 inches.
Well, that painting, that's one of the prime examples, I think, of the larger than life idea, because the whole concept of the show was to paint things that were bigger than you see them.
Right.
So,
in fact, I kind of wanted the viewer to feel like they've gotten a little smaller when they walk in. You know what I mean? Like, you walk in and suddenly your whole world is bigger than it normally is, so maybe it makes you feel like a little mm-hmm. smaller, just so there's a different perspective
yeah.
by the viewer when mm-hmm. when they step into the gallery. Yep. So there's a few more in this show.
Okay, and
That one's Wild Equine, too. Okay, this is a watercolor.
Okay.
This is actually called Wine Decanters. It's okay. Actually my husband's grandfather's wine decanters that he inherited. Mm-hmm. And I just used bits and pieces of them, overlapping positive and negative, just scattered color through, and just sort of used the general shapes to sort of create an abstract with the different wine decanters.
It has somewhat of a post-cubist look.
It does. It's almost almost sort of a mid-century modern, which is funny because it's... Mm-hmm. I'm actually into mid-century modern, but I wasn't when I did this. You know, when I started this painting, it wasn't. So.
Mm-hmm. It is reminiscent of that. It's like Stuart Davis and who else?
Yeah.
Some other people that were working in that.
But it was completely just putting a couple wine decanters on my desk and painting from them. You know, looking mm-hmm. at them and working in positive, negative, back forth.
Yeah, I think that's a really I think tabletop still life mm-hmm. has really kind of disappeared from the art scene, you know, except for flower painting. I mean, there's a lot of flower painting, but I don't see many people doing a Giorgio Morandi anymore.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, which, you know, this kind of reminds me of that. And I think it's about time. So shall we go down some more?
We'll hop with the wild equine, the zebras.
Let's do that.
Because take a close-up look at their...
Why is it blue?
Click on him and see if he's...
Wait a second. There we go. That's it.
And if you look, I don't know if you can enlarge that to see his eyes, but his eyes are the only color on that page.
Mm.
Not sure if that will work on that computer.
That's not gonna work. Yeah.
But so you'll have to go to the gallery to see that.
Mm-hmm.
But his eyes actually are very reflective. They have reflective blues and golds and things in them.
Yeah, they're real. They're real. When you take a look at the eyes, it's almost like it's one of those paintings that you see where they have the holes in and the people are looking through.
The hardest part of doing this one was the manes. There's two manes in there
mm-hmm.
Down the back, and that's like the stripes get soft, but they're still striped. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so to sort of maintain that and get and have that look like the mane,
right,
and yet maintain the striping of the animal was
mm-hmm.
the hardest part of that painting. That and not getting black paint all over myself. That wasn't easy. And in fact, I ended up in the final days taking those stripes, and they're all around the whole canvas. They go around the sides.
Mm-hmm. So I think that really livens it up. It really it's a great design element. But at the same time, it really
helps it to pop.
It helps it pop. Exactly.
Yeah.
So,
what else do we have here? Oh, there's a little iris.
Yeah, I think we...
That's about it. Okay, so we can go to the next.
Oh, wait.
This one's the end. This is my contribution to the political art. It's called Making Art Great Again at mm-hmm. Yocum. This was my contribution to that. This is an acrylic called 44.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a huge variety. It's not. There's absolutely not one political point of view. This show is really interesting. If you haven't seen it, you should get over there. It ends on November 6th. So you've got another week or so to see it.
Yeah.
And then it's going to be gone.
Yeah. I must say that is an excellent show. Because it like you said, there's no particular political
there
point of
so
view.
There are so many political points of view there from so many different artists. It's really, really fun to see the whole thing come together. Mm-hmm. We started out with the idea of doing, and this, I get some credit for this, but I really, I don't know that I deserve it. It's a committee that just came up with this idea. Mm-hmm. I did make contributions to that, but the whole committee of Yocum Exhibition Committee put the ideas together. There are artists that we started out with the idea of doing one political artist. Then we thought, well, let's balance that with a second idea. Well, let's balance that with like a whole lot of artists' ideas on what's happening with our political system, because everybody has different ideas, and that's bringing all those ideas together is how we're going to move forward as a country, I think. Mm-hmm. So that was part of the idea of the show.
And we all know artists are more of a liberal trend than
But yet, there's plenty of conservative ideas in the show. Plenty of, pro-Trump and anti-Trump and some of everything.
Well, let's see, we're kind
of... They're just sort of exploring it. And in fact, there's things like, there's like a painting about not closing the parks and not putting the parks up for sale. And There's so many different ideas. It's unfortunate because of technical difficulties, we had all the photographs of all those things, and we can't show them to you at this point because they won't come up on the computer.
That's what it is. But
the hydrangea there we could show if you wanted to.
Which one? Here.
Down a little bit, on the top row, the blue horizontal up.
Up more.
Mm-hmm. Right above the zebra.
Okay.
If that one shows
there
up.
There we go. Yeah, that we got that.
Doesn't come out real well on the screen, but the contrast is sort of lost. But that one was a lot of fun to work on. Again, it's almost abstract, but it's a group of hydrangeas and the leaves and plants and things. So that's also an acrylic where I used a lot of flat color.
Well, it works fine as an abstraction just on its own,
That's what I like about it, I think, that it borders on abstraction with just like little hints of plant and...
I like that gray in there. That really livens it up.
Yeah.
I think gray is one of the underrated colors.
You know, there's a... it's called Making Color Sing. It's a watercolor book. But it talks about how to make a color stand out, you surround it by... She calls them mouse colors. So if you wanted to make a yellow really stand out, you'd use mouse purple, a grayed down purple in the area around it, and the yellow pops. If you want to make the purple pop, use grayed down yellows and golds around it, and the purple's going to jump off the page.
Well, that's color theory. That's really good. That's I think every artist should learn color theory, because it's important. Color opposites and the color wheel,
right,
all that kind
the
of
color
stuff.
Wheel.
Yeah. So if you have your yellow will be on the top of the color wheel, and your purple will be on the bottom. So it's in direct opposition, just the same as green is to red and orange is to blue. It just takes that stuff. And then if you're on the color wheel and you come closer, to each other, that it makes a sort of a, then it grays it out. So that when you mix the red and the green together, it makes kind of like a muddy brown.
Yeah, just as an exercise, when I first was some of my early watercolors, I tried to do the entire painting with only the three colors, only the three primaries. Mix everything from those three primaries, which actually they weren't very strong, so it was really hard to get black.
Yeah.
But I did paint the entire painting with just, and it was a painting of a dog with browns and all kinds of, so it wasn't red, yellow, and blue painting at all. It was a brown, black, and white painting, and I did it only with the three primaries.
Yeah, it's quite an exercise. It really wakes you up when you, when you're trying to paint realistically, and you want just that right color, to make it work. And I mean, there's a lot of paintings that we had on that disk drive. Yeah. I wish we could translate it here, but let's try something else here. You have go to one of the other locations here on your. Want to go abstracts, landscapes?
Do abstracts.
Okay,
that's fun.
Okay.
This top one actually is also in the jazz section because this was a piece I had in the jazz show.
Mm-hmm. So this is acrylic as well.
This is a real mixed media.
Ah,
this started out as watercolor. Then it has acrylic. Some of the leaves and things are pushed into acrylic and put acrylic around them. And
then, so you actually have leaves in this?
Not actual leaves, but the leaves are pushed into the paint and then lifted back out again.
Uh-huh.
Some of them to get some texture.
Oh, I see. So
And then the darkest, the black and stuff, that's all pastel over top of the whole thing.
Wow. It's hard to tell sometimes when you see it on, you know, on a computer screen or a television screen, because it tends to the colors seem to merge, you know, according to the pixelation. We were talking earlier, you and I, about experimentation.
Right.
And that's a big topic with me. I really like your point of view on that. Do you want to tell us about
I always feel like I sort of self-criticize that I don't have a one consistent style that you can just say, oh, there's a Lynn Millar.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's like you would know there's a Jackson Pollock, at least from a certain period in his life.
Right.
But I really would get bored with that. I couldn't do one style day in and day out. To me, it's all about experimenting and trying new things and you know, just letting the creativity go. I have to do that.
Seeing what you can come up with.
Seeing what I come up with, what I can. Mm-hmm. And I think we'll see one of the paintings, a new painting that I just did last weekend, which is a whole new series. I've just started where I'm trying to simplify, like taking landscapes and taking them down to as simple as possible. That'll be in the landscape section probably.
Okay. But while we're here, let's take another look at it.
Okay, so let's take a look. In fact, those orange and red ones are in that one and the other one.
Okay.
Those are in my living room. They're Pyro 1 and Pyro 2. And to me, they're just, I did those. Those are casein, which is almost like milk tempera is how you would describe it. Mm-hmm. The milk makes it permanent eventually.
Mm-hmm.
The Egyptians used it.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of the oldest paints there are. And it has almost like a liquid pastel effect when you see it in person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of them used to mix egg white with it. Yeah, that gave it that.
To make an egg tempera. But this is casein, which is milk tempera. And it's almost like the tempera paint you used in school. I have a few of them. And I really enjoyed that medium. I like the beefiness of it, and I like the lack of plastic.
Mm.
But I do feel that I need to cover it with glass. So that one of the things I like about acrylic is I don't have to cover them.
And
you're one to one with the paint.
Mm-hmm.
Where with the watercolor and the casein, I do put glazing over them to protect them from damage.
Well, if they get wet,
Or scratched.
Yeah,
this would be sensitive to scratch, like a pastel would be.
Yeah, yeah.
So they need some kind of protection. But I do love the medium.
Oh yeah. All right.
And then the other one below it is the other half of that. The two of those are hanging in my living room. This is Pyro 2.
Okay.
And I did these while I was on the phone with my sister, just talking away about some total different subject. Did the whole both these paintings. I was working them at my desk while I'm on the phone, not paying any attention to what I was doing. So they totally came out of my creative side with no thought.
Subconscious there,
completely out of my subconscious. It just sort of all happened, you know. And when I was finished, it was like, oh, well, goodbye, Beth. Like, wow. What did I do?
So what size are these again, you said?
Those, I believe those are about 16 by 20.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they might be 20 by 24. I can't remember. It's been a few years since I framed them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I really, really enjoyed them.
Remind me when we're done here. I have something for you. Then that you were talking about tempera and acrylic.
Mm-hmm.
I have some big canisters of powder.
Pigment. Oh yeah.
I'm not using them. If you'd like them.
Oh. All right. Well, let's check out some other abstracts here. There's a series there to your left. Those are called action abstracts. And those are mostly all done with squirting color. from squirt bottles and different objects that I can find. Lighter and darker colors. I lay things into them to make patterns. The sort of grassy patterns on the, in the gold are done with little slivers of wax paper that I just cut out. And after I get the wet paint in there, I just lay them in and let it dry with the wax paper laying in there, and then peel it back off again.
So you're doing like a reverse printing, like a monotype in a way.
Well, sort of, but they're like bits and pieces I just like lay in. And what happens with different colors, the colors sort of coagulate, and because they're kept wet, they dry at a different time period so that they come out a little differently. They just, the pigments drop out of it just a little differently. It's one of the neat things about watercolor is that the pigments have different weights. And when you know that, you can control the textures and things you get because the pigment particles drop down into the paper at different speeds, and you can control
your
color.
The ones that have the most opacity are the most expensive ones, though, too.
Yeah, my very favorite color is ultramarine, French ultramarine blue, because of the way it textures. I mean, I like to include it into colors because I'll get that dropped out pigment texture in the painting. It's really beautiful.
Well, that's like tiles, like the ancient, like not Sumerian. They're the Saudi tiles in the Muslim temples and stuff. We're using this very expensive lapis lazuli.
Okay.
And that was, it was very rare, and they had painted with that a number of years ago, but I don't think that they can find it anymore. It's a crystalline powder.
But it's interesting that by knowing the weights of your pigments in your colors, you can control a lot of things that you might not have ever guessed you could control in a painting. It's one of the things about watercolor that you wouldn't have that in acrylic or oils or anything. It's really only in watercolor where the pigments drop out like that.
Well, and with watercolor too, you can actually subtract some of the pigments from the paper.
Absolutely. I will see that in the jazz picture, that brass. But we can go back and look at a few more of these.
Okay.
That's also an action abstract. Very similar to the other one, but I don't think quite as successful. But I like it, but it's not, doesn't quite make it. But I like that real intense color I used at the end. Kind of give it that dark snap.
Oh, yeah. Well, that black against the blue really does wake it up.
Yeah. There's a couple more on that page, I think, down further. These are a few more. The middle one, it sort of falls into action abstract, but it's actually, it's called Bamboo. And there again, I squirted some color, then I lay strips of wax paper in there, then squirted some more color, then laid strips of wax paper in to kind of layer it so that you got the feeling of depth. And, so it's almost an action abstract, but it actually has a little bit of a realism in there with the bamboo.
Well, I like the way that it's the positive negative application of it, where it seems that the actual bamboo is subtracted from the surface.
Right, and it's just because the strips of paper are laying on it while I'm adding the color.
What do they call that stuff? Miskit or frisket?
Well, there is, but this is just wax paper like you'd cook with.
Okay.
I just, there's tape, there's all kinds of things you can use. Someone said to me, I didn't really like the tape that you put in there. I said, well, this isn't, actually, I cut individually each strip. And I cut them so that they're different at the top and the bottom, as a living thing would be.
Right.
And this person said, it's all one. No, it's not one width. It's each one is different, and it's hand cut. But whatever.
It's close, but no.
Right. I mean,
no cigar.
Maybe it should have been more different. I don't know. But
yeah, that's fine.
I mean, bamboo is not that different top to bottom. Yeah. A piece of bamboo is almost the same width. The whole it sort of grows out.
Yeah, I like bamboo. I was going to make a sculpture with one, but it just I don't know. I'm not too much on sculpture.
It's not too easy to work with.
No.
It's not the easy. It's very, very hard wood, actually.
Very hard wood. You have to, like, boil it and bend it and wrap it around things. It's just...
Oh, so the circle here, and I can't remember the title anymore, but one of the next ones, the one to the left there, that's actually a combination of watercolor and pastel.
It's nice. I like the way the color blends together there. And it's a good combination of the, you know, it's that red makes it work. You really have a good touch with red.
Yeah, that was a fun one to work on. Because I like it when you're sort of balancing accident and intent and plan, mm-hmm. and then work in with your, you know, some of the accident controls parts of it, and then you can sort of work out the rest of it with a plan. Yeah. And that was one of them.
Now, this one here was the one that you had used to get into the Watercolor Society.
Yeah, this actually was the final one that got me into Philadelphia Watercolor Society. This was in the Goggle Works a few years ago. Mm-hmm. And that was my second piece so that I could apply for membership in the signature membership in the Philadelphia Watercolor Society. Mm-hmm. That was an old metal something or other. I never knew what it was. I found it in a field years ago and took a picture of it, but never knew what quite to do with it. Mm. And this painting, actually I did several paintings of this. I did a whole series on rust. I just decided I really loved rust and the color. I just like, there's something, there's like a depth to it and things that I just really enjoy. So I really enjoyed doing this painting. I like that you can kind of see through in a few of those holes. You can see back in through the back. It's open. I guess it was some kind of a pressure steam engine thing. Look at all that. All those little.
It looks like a drainage plate or something.
It was sitting in the field just like that. It was upright. Uh-huh. That was the top. It was sitting there.
Huh.
And see all the pipes and stuff off to the left and
yeah.
a little cap and like maybe a pressurizer or something. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But
oh, yeah.
It was just in a field. And so I sort of took the object, but then I sort of abstracted the background a little bit, putting the dots in, and which I did with Q-tips.
I like how you use alternative tools and means of creating a work.
Yeah. Well, when we get into the abstract, when we get into the landscapes, I'll show you one landscape that has not a single brush stroke on it.
Right.
So watercolor with no brushes.
So shall we go to the landscapes?
We could go to the landscapes.
Yeah, because we're...
How are we doing on time?
We've got about 20 minutes yet.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
All right. And I apologize to all these artists that got art for me that I could so I could show them for the...
Mm-hmm. Well, that was my fault. I should have had you send the images to me. So,
this one actually has little or no brush. I don't know that this one has any brush either.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't the one I meant. The other one's further down the page, which we'll see in a minute. But I use mostly spray bottles, masking off parts of it with my hand and different objects, paper towels, different things.
Mm-hmm.
And then I use squirt bottles to make the grapevines there in the front. This is a vineyard. I use squirt bottles to squirt the intense color.
So you're actually spraying the color onto it?
Yeah, I spray it on with a spray bottle.
Mm-hmm.
I use old hair spray bottles and whatever. Mm-hmm. And different ones have different textures and things. So you need a variety. You can't just have one.
Right, you can spray it on, and it'll go out in a big, in a big dusty spray, or some will just go out like a squirt.
Yeah, and then at the bottom right there, there's a doily that I laid on and sprayed watercolor through the doily.
Oh, just touch that.
The bottom right, that sort of half of it sort of showing at the bottom there.
Right there.
Yeah.
Yeah. See if they can see that. Yeah.
The bottom right. Okay. Yep, right there.
Okay.
All right, let's move on to
the next one.
See what else we have here.
So
this series is something, this is called 19606. It's the viaduct over there.
Mm-hmm.
And in this group, I basically, these are acrylic. I just spray, smear, scrape color till I like the background.
Mm-hmm.
And then draw. It's acrylic ink, I'm going to call it. It's really acrylic paint, but it's got the consistency of ink. Mm-hmm. And goes into a little marker that's designed just for that.
Oh, so this is an acrylic marker.
It's an acrylic. It's a refillable marker.
Uh-huh.
I take my acrylic paint, put in this empty marker, mm-hmm. any color I want, mm-hmm. but I like the black the best. And you draw with the marker, and then mm-hmm. you wash it out. And it is really time-consuming to keep them clean and keep them working.
Right, because they clog pretty easily.
They clog, yeah.
Yeah. That's good.
But it's fun. In fact, that one, I think I used some pen and different things to.
Yeah, to get
make some the line, some of the finer lines.
Mm-hmm.
This one's done from down around. excuse me, the Goggle Works.
Mm-hmm.
This is a city of Reading too.
Yeah, I recognize the building shapes and the huge tower.
Yeah.
Smokestack, yeah.
Yep, so that's from mm-hmm. down in that area. And again, now this time I used, instead of black, I used the dark blue
mm-hmm.
acrylic paint in the marker. And actually this one was done with a pen and a brush and a bunch of things, but it included, some of it is the marker too.
Well, it's mixed media. You use a lot of different things in it.
Yeah, well, I use a lot of different applicators, but it wouldn't be considered mixed media because it's all acrylic.
Oh, I see. So it's just different ways of applying.
Yeah, the applicators are different, but the medium itself is all acrylic. So, although it is on paper, these last two, both of them are on paper.
Uh-huh. And how do you you have the impression like a stencil of the numbers up in the like in the upper left?
You know, my son bought a house, and it belonged to the Hinterschitz family from years ago when they had a mill or something. And mm-hmm. in that basement, when he was cleaning it out, he found their stencils that they would stencil on their bags when they would send them out to the store. And so I have this set of antique stencils.
Wow.
You can't find the type style anywhere else. I've looked around. I wanted to give him his stencils back. You can't find the type style. I love the type style. And I can't find it anywhere else. So I've still got my son's stencils.
Well,
and the Hinterschitz family is talking about using them in a holiday card or something this year because they like them too.
Oh, yeah. You know, my parents bought a house that was owned by the Hinterschitz family.
There's a lot of them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. This one was built in like 1860s or something. It's an old log house.
Man, you've got a very good eye, I think.
I'm having a lot of fun. This is just a little one, and actually we talked about this.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about donations. This actually I donated to the Democratic Party picnic as a donation item.
Mm-hmm.
And it was won by somebody I know in the party.
Mm-hmm.
But this is from like up in the row houses in Reading. And it just appeals to me.
Mm-hmm.
I just enjoyed the picking out a few lit windows and a little bit of moonlight hitting a few things. And
mm-hmm. Yeah, it actually, you can see the Mount Penn in the background mm-hmm. of it. And that moon is huge, by the way.
Yeah, it's just fun.
Yeah, well, there's nothing wrong with that.
Made the point.
It did. It made the point. So,
and these are from like Gary, Indiana. We were just talking about how Indiana is such a flat kind of, don't tell from people from Indiana, but it's a little bit boring. But I just love these old retired factory buildings and iron works and everything. I just think they're mm-hmm. they just really interest me. So that's what I photograph when we go through that area. These are Minneapolis. That's where we were driving through Indiana to get to Minneapolis. We have a son that lives in Minneapolis, so we go there. Mm-hmm. We often fly these days, but sometimes we drive. And this is just some of the smokestacks of Minneapolis. They have some really nice scenes and some beautiful lake areas, and you can really find an interesting, beautiful lake backed up by big factory buildings and lots of contrast of subject matter around the city. It's really, I enjoy painting cities, and Minneapolis is one of the prettiest ones.
Never been there.
I recommend it. Good art, good galleries, good all kinds of things. This also is Minneapolis. This is probably the Mississippi going underneath the, it starts up there.
Yeah, you can see the viaduct there.
Yeah, that's the viaduct. I think that's the Mississippi coming through there.
Cool. So before we run out of time here, I'd like to ask about some of the things that are happening with you lately. We were going to talk about Make Art Great Again.
Right. And we did mention that, and I think that's really a show worth seeing. I think everybody should get over there and see that before it closes in about a week and a half.
Yeah, yeah.
The other things that we have going on right now, we just opened Larger Than Life last Friday night, and that will be until, I think it's November 26th, somewhere around in there, Larger Than Life will be in. That's the one where lots of artists put pieces in of things that are just a little bigger than you might expect them to be. And hopefully that'll make you feel a little smaller. There's a lot of good art in there. This was my idea. I took it to Sue Bebeck, who's the manager. And together we rounded up and invited the artists that to be in it. And there were times when I thought, I hope we have enough artists. Are we going to have enough art? You know, and we ended up with so much stuff, we didn't know if we were going to fit it all in. It was just packed. She said at one point, she said, I have to have two more pieces. I've got to find a place for these two more paintings. So we really got a lot of artists. It's really a neat show. I'm really pleased with it.
Oh, yeah, we had some excellent pieces in that show by Jim Meehan. He had that huge.
Oh, that piece is so neat. It's like walking a spacewalk or something.
Yeah, the guy is wearing like a bathospheric head.
Right.
Has like he's a deep sea diver, and then he has these huge wings. I wish I could show it to you.
Thing is like eight feet wide or 10 feet.
It's 10 feet wide.
It takes up a whole wall.
It does. It's magnificent. A lot of
whole room is the black and white room, if you noticed. I don't know if you know, but there's very little color in that room. It's almost everything in there is black and white.
That's where your zebra is.
And the zebras are in there, yeah.
So, and it was a Sarah Iannozzi.
Okay.
Had those two images in there of the moon.
Oh,
Against the trees.
Yes.
Winter trees and the winter moon. Her rendition of the moon was absolutely spectacular. I mean, you could see a crater in
every. It puts you in the mood, doesn't it? Something about the moon that puts you in the mood, and those paintings really do it. They really do it. Really nice.
We suggest that's a good show to get to is that, and the Make Art Great Again closes in a week and a half.
Yep.
And there's works in there by David Nally.
Vicky Rodier.
Amy Shade.
Donna Singleton. I think who they saw the other.
There's another Donna.
Everybody.
There's a lot of people in
Everybody's in that show. Everybody had an opinion on the politics of today, and they worked it out in art. And it's fun to look at.
Yeah, like the one painting. I'm trying to remember the artist's name, but I loved this painting. It was a picture of the White House, and it was all in gold trim with a big gold T on the front of it and an oil well in the front yard. That says pretty much White House decorations by an unknown by an anonymous person
and decorator. Yeah. So. It was fun. So that's enjoyable. The next Yocum is actually looking for artists. So if you're an artist, we're going to invite you to be part of this. It's called, and without my cheat sheet is on the computer, and I'm not be. But we're going to call it the Petite Show. It's got, the whole name is longer than that, and it talks about, it's all in French. But for the most part, it just means little art. So if you've got some small pieces you would like to share, we're going to try and fill the gallery with lots of small pieces of art. That lets us include a lot of artists that maybe have never shown there before. So if you're one of those, join us.
Right, and there is no fee to join this, right?
No fee.
There's no fee to join this.
If piece sells, they do take a commission, and I can't quote you exactly what that is. You can check with them if you'd like to.
Mm-hmm.
But
I thought it's either 15% or 30%. Yeah. Hopefully it's 15.
I'm not sure, but anyway.
Yeah.
Join us. And come on out and get a piece of work up that you had just needs to be ready to hang. So it's good to be framed. In some way, we have to be able to hang it. Or we probably will have some bin work. If you want bin work, you're going to have to call and ask and check with them. What else is coming up? Is there anything else coming up?
Yours truly is having a show right now over at Alvernia College at the Millar Gallery. So if you would like to attend that, come on over and see my stuff, it looks pretty good. It's called Assembled Paintings Part 2, and it's a continuation of the paintings that are on exhibit right now over at the New Arts Program in Kutztown, because I have about 70 works in that. So it's a lot of pieces, and 28 pieces over at Alvernia, which are just larger.
You've been busy.
Oh, my God. You have no idea. So feel free to come by that if I can shamelessly self-promote myself. For yourself, what are you working on right now?
Well, go down that landscape page and look and see if that new stuff is there. I just started doing a series of simplifying the arts. Simplifying the landscape so that to get rid of as much detail as possible.
Okay.
And these are watercolor series, and I don't see them. Go down the page further, see if it's down there. I'm not positive I put it on my window, but there's that.
Which?
I bet people would like to see that cow.
My.
But at any rate.
There we go.
I'll be putting some pieces out. With they're mostly buildings, Goggle Works area, and some other buildings that I did, and I just try and break them down to the simplest possible shapes, getting rid of all the excess, and even simplifying the colors. And actually, it's sort of a color range. This is Lobethal Fields, it's called. This is in Australia. In the Adelaide Hills, this was a beef steer we came across. He and his buddies were out chomping away at the grasses, and they stopped to say hello to us as we drove by. So we stopped and took their picture and turned it into a painting.
Very nice.
And actually, this one got shipped back to Australia. Above that, two rows up, right up, is that one that painted right there. That's the one that has go up another one. Actually, that one used Q-tips and wax paper, or Q-tips and saran wrap to get those textures.
Now, what scale is this? What size are we looking at?
That is 30 inches wide by 11 inches high.
Wow.
So that's a half sheet watercolor. But I take the full width, the largest width, and fold it in half the other way. So keep going up. There. See on the left there? Down. That's the one.
That's the one?
This painting has no brush strokes in it, believe it or not. That is the biggest view of a vineyard all in one continuous motion that you'll see. I had to take several photographs and put them together to get that, the full view.
And how large is that piece?
Same size. The whole series is all the same size.
Uh-huh.
It's all full sheet, 30-inch width, and then half. So it's called half sheet, but it's 11 inches high. So that whole series is that whole Australia landscape series. It's the same size.
Yeah, I think that would be really nice.
Goodbye.
We've been given the goodbye code here.
Yeah.
So I suppose we have to just shut down. But anyway, I could have talked much more with you.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I hope our viewers had a good time finding out a lot of interesting things about watercolor and other kinds of painting.
Well, it must have been interesting. They didn't, nobody called.
Sounds good.
Anyway, Lynn, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you for joining us here on NAP Connection. Mm-hmm. And my guest, Lynn Millar, painter, artist extraordinaire, and myself, Ron Schira, I'm the host, and have a wonderful evening. Join us again.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studio in Reading, PA, airing live on the fourth Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. Check your local listings for repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts Program, call 610-683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5 p.m., Saturday, 10 to 2 p.m., or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency.